My poor father has been attacked all night and all day. And I get messages on the computer from soldiers, like my husband's kids are in the army, telling me, leave my loving husband, throw my life away, and leave things to my stepkids, or my dad won't make it. They're using military weapons on him. I can't hardly get him to wake up today. Someone did a spell. They went into the booth that I got Avon, where I have Avon on display, left a wicker basket, then sent me a thing about wicker baskets on the wicker man. And they told me a week ago they were gonna fire my husband, send him to hell. My father has got the biggest heart, and he was during the war, he used to pick up all the wounded, and he never lost a single person. They thought that was pretty miraculous that my dad's unit on the medvacs never lost anyone. And they were the favorite unit. The colonels and everyone all said that they always loved it when they saw their helicopter, because they knew that they were going to protect men. My dad never had an easy road his whole life. He worked for anything he ever had. His dad owned a garage, McDowell's Garage, but my dad used to ride his bicycle delivering prescriptions to get his first car. After that, he had me. He got drafted, and he had been in a major automobile accident. He had glass coming out of under his eyes. He had gangrene set in his eye, broke his arms, and people said, the police said when they saw the car flipped over the interstate, well, we don't have to be in a rush because there's somebody's going to survive that accident. But luckily, everyone was so crammed in the car. But my dad got it. His doctor tried to get him not to go to the military. He said, you know, they can get into your brain. They can kill you. He was trying to give him a pass. His mom was trying to get him to take a pass. But my dad said, I want to do the right thing. You know, I want to help people. Sweet, sweet father. And it was a horrible experience for him. After he'd been there so long, he used to write my mom love letters. And she had me while he was there. And he didn't get to see me for a long time. But she sent me pictures and called me his little princess. And they had it rough for a long time. And my mother had to waitress and everything. But they're such great people. And then after the military, I remember the soldiers were treated terrible. But, you know, they were treated like criminals when they had been heroes. But my dad got a letter from the president. He got all kinds of medals. And, you know, he never showed me. And later my grandma showed me. And she said he won't talk about the war. He never would mention it. And then when I finally said, Dad, you're a hero. Why didn't you tell me, you know, about your letter? Why didn't you tell me about these medals? And he said, no one ever wins in war, Sherry. And then he realized a week ago, something he never told me. You know, he never missed a day of work. I mean, a day of school from first grade to sixth. His sister said he raised himself because his mother had to work so hard. She bought a house. She worked in a laundry. She never missed a day of work. But a lot of times she'd have to drop him off at aunts and uncles, and he would only see her on the weekends. But he pretty much went to school on his own, got himself up for every day for school. He used to play with his friends in the West End. They had all kinds of ball game teams, and they'd play on the bridge, and they would swim in the Ohio River. He was a very tender-hearted, kind boy, but you know they never got any toys, not one toy. I didn't know that till a few years ago. He started like getting these little things that his friend would get him, M&M holders and cutesy toy looking like little banks and things, and his friend would get them for him, and he'd decorate. And I'm like, Dad, this isn't you, is it? This is kind of childish. And then I figured out later, his sister said he never got a toy. And I, what do you mean he never got a toy? And then I said, Dad, did you never get one toy in your whole childhood? Because you made sure we had presents for every Christmas and birthday. And he said, no. He said, but my dad promised me a train set one time. And I'm like, really? And he was all excited. So I said, did he get it for you? And he goes, no. He said he put it on layaway, but he never got it. That's been my dad's whole life. And his luck has been terrible. I remember when he first retired from the tobacco company, where he worked like a slave in a factory with no windows, in the heat, and in the silos, doing horrible work. He wasn't allowed to miss work. In those days, you could not miss. You'd lose your job. If you had 3 days with a doctor's excuse, that was it. He slaved for years to provide. And He wanted to be sure that for high school, he bought me my first car when I graduated. He wanted to be sure that he got me what I needed. And we only got presents for holidays, but he tried to, at the holiday, go overboard. And I remember when he first retired, the first week, I said, "Dad, celebrate." "No, I'm not going to celebrate." He was afraid. I'm like, you work so hard. Aren't you happy to be retired?" "Oh, nobody that I know that retired gets by without a heart attack." He goes, "Or they die." He says, "Every time somebody at Philip Morris dies, they have a heart attack." And I said, "Dad, don't be ridiculous. You're not going to have a heart attack." Month after retirement, he had a heart attack. Then the other heart attack, he was at the UK game. And my father is so strong, he would not go to the hospital. He wanted to wait and see what the score was. He waited till the game was over, then he walked across the parking lot because he never would have made anybody make a fuss over him, but he wouldn't call an ambulance. They drove him to the hospital and he had one. But my dad has pride and he's a man and he's strong. He'll never ask anybody for assistance or anything, never ask them for a favor. What do you know? They went to the hospital and this group that's attacking me, they got so mad at me trying to save the world and expose evil and do and try to listen to God that they hurt him. And that wasn't good enough. And they do things that are so petty. Well, to make a long story short, I get home tonight and I get these messages on my Pinterest that I'm supposed to be a human sacrifice and leave my husband high and dry with no one in the world to love him. He says I'm the only person. Break his heart, torture him for a very vindictive group. A long time ago, his kids, who had not had anything to do with him, wanted to get in touch. And that day when Justin came to town, he said on government business, someone was making our garage doors go up and down. And his son, Chris, sent him a letter after Bob said, "Because you kids have cut me off for years and I've gone out of town trying to see you. I've got lawyers. I've done everything. And you listened to your mom and sided with her new husband. I'm going to cut most of you out of the will and leave everything, leave what I had put aside for you before I met Sherry to the grandkids." Then he got a letter from Chris. "We're going to meet this dark group. Our life will never be the same. And I'm going to be penniless." This was before all this started happening. And then next thing you know, Justin contacts his father and wants to know my birth date, which is crazy because he never sent us a Father's Day card, a school picture, or a birthday card the whole time he lived with his mom. And he left when he was like in second grade and didn't come back. And then the stepdaughter calls and writes and wants to know Bob's birthday. Well, they knew. But I know if you're in the Illuminati, I've heard you have to put someone like a sacrifice list. But after that, I started slowing being an experiment, a government experiment, being murdered. But before this happened, there were some people at the Stephen King site after my work was stolen. They started telling me what I was doing inside my own home they could only know with cameras. Then they started bringing up Bob's past and trying to say he didn't pay child support. He always paid child support, always. But while they were stealing from me, they tried to dig into our family past to see if there was any tension anywhere, anything bad. Well, I do remember my husband's wife's best friend lived on their street. And she was staying at their house, but she wouldn't tell her kids she was in town. We had the kids all but the baby and Chris, because Chris had attacked his father and he got put in a mental institution. And then she shipped him off to Florida Air Academy because she was afraid of him. So he was in Florida Air Academy, and the baby, she wanted the baby, but Bob said she only liked babies. She didn't want the other kids. So she said, "If you agree to let me have Sasha, you can have all the other kids and I'll move out of state." And she signed over legal custody of all the kids to Bob. She signed it. But Bob, because her friend had such pull in court and politics, Bob was not allowed to show where she had signed over full custody. And later, whenever she married this other guy who couldn't keep a job, she decided to take the kids back, but they wanted the money. They wanted the money. And you know, she plotted and schemed. I would send Justin down to play with the Secret Service agent's son a few times a week. Every time Pam would call his wife and say, "Can Justin come to play?" Because Bob had always let him do it. I let him go down on the same street to play. Well, this man stayed Justin's friend his whole life. And whenever they went to live with a stepmom, he convinced Justin to join the military. And then Justin later is on the TV in Afghanistan, and now he's the only Secret Service agent selling weapons for the Army. But my husband lost his kids. And it was because of lies. The mother lied to those kids. When I first went in the house, she didn't want them. But then later, she decided to because her husband couldn't keep a job. And then I remember how devastating it was when I first got the paperwork that she was taking us to court. Do you know they got us up on our honeymoon? They called us at 7:30 in the morning. And we had the kids because I had flown them in because I wanted them in my wedding. I wasn't going to get married unless they could be in it. She got married at the courthouse and didn't even let them know. And they had spent the night with us on our wedding night, and she got me out of bed 7:30 on our wedding just to try to harass us. Every anniversary, she'd try to send us a court motion with lies just to stay in Bob's life. She had Tava send us things on our anniversaries. And it was horrible, the things that she would do to try to destroy our relationship. She was just that wicked. She didn't want her kids, but she didn't want to let Bob be happy. She hated him, absolutely hated him. She didn't do it because she cared about him. She did it for control. She just was a broken person. Well, her children grew up to believe her lies. She wanted total adoration from him and nothing else. But she told them that I was the reason that the kids had been taken away, because she said that I was a slut. Because Bob fell for me. I was not a slut at all. But she convinced them I was. And she had abortions. She didn't want her own children. And she would make up any story she could. So she poisoned her kids. So tonight they're saying all the things that she said to the kids to me. Oh, well, the relationship broke up because you were a hoe. And a man will leave his family for a hoe. And I'm like, that woman had been remarried, living out of state, 16 months, had her little girl hanging out at the pool with the man she married. And he said the reason he married her is because he liked their little four-year-old. She was four at the time, which was very strange. But she had already abandoned her children and given over full legal custody before I ever met my husband. And I would never let them see me kiss my husband. They never knew that if we ever had sex before marriage. If I did spend the night, I would sleep in bed with the girls, and I would pretend that we didn't have sex until we got married. So that is total, utter nonsense. But she told them everything she could, and then tonight they're telling me these things. So I just want to tell you how the world, this country, has fallen into hell. When you raise kids like this that want to kill me or want to just try to attack me, because the government comes along and steals my stuff through the film industry and says, hey, you know, Warner Brothers and all that, who's part of MK Ultra, Disney, linked to government, they're the sick, they're psychopaths. There's no professionalism, there's no honesty, there's no goodness. They come along and say, well, let's torture them because we get off on suffering. And they really do. They would come into the Stephen King site when they were still in my material at different publishing sites, and they would tell us all about our life. And they will say, well, we bet you don't pay child support. And my husband didn't have his youngest. And he was still giving child support on Sasha. And he couldn't even see her when she went to live with her mom. But I remember the funniest thing is when I first, before when Bob asked me to marry him, I turned him down at first because I knew it would be hell with his ex-wife. And I remember saying to him, I love you, and I hope we can stay together, but she's giving you ultimatums. She's telling you that if you marry me, she's going to replace you with the stepdad, replace your love. And the two girlfriends he had before me, she tried to break him up with. One was Becky, and she would took her shopping. And the other one was a Brazilian woman that he was engaged to. And she started wanting to go shopping with her. And Tava said it was to break them up. Well, I was someone she couldn't do that with. So if I went shopping, she would have her friend Chris come and spy on us and try to talk to me, her best friend. And I would be friendly because I was naive as all get out. You know, I used to be nannies and stuff in different cities, and I took care of all kinds of kids, and I was always good to all the parents. I was trusting, but this woman taught me how to be a fighter. When I saw her hurt her own children, she taught me how to be a fighter. And I remember the day his attorney said, put him on the plane, and I refused, and he said, you'll be in contempt of court. I was devastated. I called up the people on the other side in tears, and I said, I just want to let you know you ruined those children's lives. You just sent them to the devil. And I was so devastated for a year, but my husband was devastated nonstop. And he was devastated because he had sacrificed and taken care of all the kids through their small years, diapering them, giving them medicine. He had diapered them and taken care of them. She had left him 3 different times and went and opened businesses in Florida and other cities. He put her in different businesses. They went bankrupt in a year. But he tried to keep her by taking, he was the Mr. Mom. But he had rocked them to sleep, read them bedtime stories every night. He had had them in the best schools money could buy. And then when she got them, she put them in bad schools. She moved them around all the time so that their grades were lousy. But you know, he never got acknowledgement. They never once said, thank you, Dad. Not a single one of them. Not, it's because she gave them that kind of hatred. And I'll show you. She was born on September 15th. And in the Book of Days, it says that her tarot is the devil. The devil. And she was born on the day of mastery. Believe me, when you're best friends with a Secret Service agent, and you got all the women in the neighborhood watching your kids because you don't want to take care of them, and you're always getting these little women's clubs, and you get people to fight your battles for you when you're a lousy mom, that it takes some serious masterful skill right there. And that's the kind of person she was. She did a photo shoot. She left her kids once, Bob said, because she wanted to be an actress. And then other times, she just said they didn't fit into her lifestyle before she left him. Kids do not fit into my lifestyle. Now, all of a sudden, I'm losing my home, my husband, everything, because the government and the film industry are breeding the kind of soldiers and families, broken families, that have no love, that believe in lies, trickery. It's all about being productive and being aggressive. Like the people you see running the world are like a bunch of attorneys. Well, his ex was like an attorney. She lied in court all the time. She had a ruthless female lawyer. And my God, I never saw so many people lie. And when you see the people that are affiliated with government people that she is, they're all just a bunch of snakes, thieves and liars and everything. And so the hardest thing, they want to pick on me now because I have a heart. Because, you know, they've offered me fame and things, and I say, no, you're big people, and you, but I'm a small person with a big heart. I don't belong in your world. Why can't you leave me alone? But the people in this world, running the world, are just like the kind of broken people that she is. They're petty, they're jealous, they're cunning, they're just a bunch of cutthroat lawyers, and they raise their kids to all be about show and wealth and deception. I've seen it spread. But before I married my husband, I kept having a dream about water moccasins. And I thought it was some kind of premonition not to get married. And I was really scared. And I just felt like that house had something evil in it. And later people said that. And they said it was the fury that he and his ex had that brought something evil into the house, because there were always friction between them. They were always at odds. And I only saw how it hurt the children. That was just one family. But when you see the people talking the kids into joining the military, her and her friend, and you see her new kids join the military, then you can see how the whole world is become enslaved by the Antichrist, because the military is now running things, and a lot of military people are building pagan shrines. And if you go to their site, they have all that witchcraft stuff. And they're trying to get me to change, but this was all high up. The degrading me every day, keeping me at the computer writing while calling me names, putting me down all the time. I think I'd already been on some kind of list. You know, when you've got that kind of pull, both his sons are in special forces. I mean, when you have that kind of pull, you can make anyone a slave. and that's what happened. But the hardest thing for me is them telling me now to leave the man who says I'm the only person in the world that he's got after he's been given cancer and suffered. How can I do that to the man who is my whole life? They had all these years to come and see him. They're still welcome to come and see him. They don't want to. How can I do that? But they're telling me they're going to destroy my father. And if I don't, it's just some sick game. But not to me, it's real. And I just want to show you what's happened to the world, that someone like me who can be so close to God that I put God first and my love comes first and God works miracles for me because he knows I'm all about love. And you can have people who don't know God, who God doesn't work miracles for, who don't have a heart, who hurt others, running, just having a ball, hurting people like me by killing us to steal our heart because God's in it. That shows you there's no hope for the world. It's going to be destroyed. There's no hope for tomorrow. My heart has always been my greatest gift, and my selfless nature, and my trust and my kindness to strangers, my husband said is what melted him the most. That's the person I was years ago before all these court battles with his ex and seeing how the kids were just pulled apart and other kids were pulled apart and all this suffering in the world. I was just a very happy-go-lucky, free spirit, giving person. But these people got into my head and they created, I think, mental illness. And they started programming my mind, and they were working me years ago. And then they would get off on just manipulating me. And so they actually pick on children. And if you read some of their stories, you will see how they love to pick on vulnerable people or mental patients or children. That's for the devil. They're sacrificing people today and creating suffering for the devil. They really are. There's no one here anymore to protect the meek. There's no one to protect the children at all. And so right now they're telling me either leave the man who adores you and make his life hell and give over everything that you've built together through your love and unity to predators like film people and these other people who only use and attack, or do more damage to Dad. And I just was telling God tonight, please take me, God. Just kill me. Kill me right now. Please get me out of my misery. And I'm asking him, why won't he take me? You know, I'm thinking, God, if you're on my side, spare me, you know, because I don't want to sacrifice any love. No. There's no right decision. I don't want to hurt the man I love. And I also don't want to sacrifice an innocent baby. And they tell me this outlandish story. They want to impregnate me and then have people eat this baby. That's what they want to turn the people in the world into that love Christ. They want to try to make us do something harmful to an innocent child, or sacrifice our husband, or give our heart away. You know, I'm just broke.